So great to be together with you. I love being in front of you. I love being able to share scripture together. It's just a great time for us to be in the Word together, to learn together. This is the last message from James before we start into our Advent season, which is crazy to think that Christmas is going to be here, but we've talked about all these Christmas things, and so next week we're gonna head into an Advent message theme. But the beauty is, I think that God has used this series to change us. I've been able to pray with some of you. I've heard stories. I've read connection cards and emails and saw places and know that God has met you. Know that God has changed you and that he's spoken to you through the series, which is awesome. And I'm glad to hear that God is convicting and changing and transforming lives and restoring relationships. This is good stuff, church. We believe in and we follow and we acknowledge and we trust in. We have faith that on our journeys, God is going to meet us. He's going to continue to change us. He's going to continue to transform us and restore us. None of us have completed the journey. None of us have finished it. None of us have arrived yet, but we're under transformation. The transforming work of the grace of God is happening in our lives. Church, this whole series is personal too. It's been convicting for me. God has changed me and he's challenged me. He's continued to work in my life as well. I, like all of you, are in the process of transformation. I've been challenged to understand that the heart of transformation is my heart, that God is changing my inside. It's not just about changing my actions and the things that I do, but it's about changing what's inside of me, and God wants that and cares about that, and the restoration that's happening is real. So my prayer, church, is that it continues to happen, that our transformation continues, that God continues to work in the restoration, redemption of lives. My prayer is that this series has reminded you of parts of your lives that need transformation, parts of your lives that God has used to this series to change those pieces. I'll be honest with you, I was supposed to speak a few weeks ago, and I switched with Luke. Luke is at the Grey Cup. He wanted to watch the Stampeders lose in their home province. Hey, isn't that cool? So... that was for you Stampeders fans. But I was changed with Luke. Luke came to me a couple weeks ago, and I was supposed to do, when we put together the series on James, there was a message, and you remember a couple weeks ago, James spoke on the taming of the tongue. That was supposed to be my message. For those of you that know me, that would have been the right message. Hey, shh. Whoa, that's a bit personal. But, so he came to me and said, Mark, I got tickets for the Grey Cup. And I said, okay, why don't I switch with you? Thinking, yes, I don't have to do that message. But God, in his, infinite wisdom, he's, again, smarter than me, again, reminded me that he's smarter than me. Not only did I not have to prepare that message, but I sat and listened to that message, so convicted once. And I had to prepare another message today, even more convicting. So... this has been a personal conviction, a transformation, and God is working in my life, and he's changing me, and I pray that that's the same for you. So today we land in chapter 5. We started in chapter 5 last week, and we're going to finish the series today in chapter 5. I don't think that James wrote chapter 1, 2, 3, all the way through 4, and then did this standalone sort of little passage at the end. Hey, I got to finish this. 20 verses seems like a good amount, and so he filled in an extra 7 verses. But this chapter flows out of the whole book. The chapter from James doesn't seem to contradict what he said in the rest of the book. It doesn't seem to be different. It doesn't seem to speak against what he talked about in chapter 4, but it goes in the same direction. And his theme of transformation and restoration of the whole person keep on going. He doesn't only in this passage talk about a physical transformation, a physical fix. And it's not only a spiritual fix that he's talking about, and it's not only something you can do alone, the things that he's talked about in the whole chapter. James has the idea, the picture of the whole transformation in mind, the whole person, spiritual, physical, and emotional. And he also reminds the reader that in this last part of it, that you can't also do it alone. You need other people, you need to gather, but you need God for this transformation. He goes back to that. I love this passage, and it's a passage that actually is marked in my Bible. Some of you maybe do the same thing, you like write in your Bible when God speaks to you through a passage, you write in there, and I put the date, April 30th, and I go back and I think, what happened then? Why this passage? This is a passage that I've used, and maybe many of you have used, right? We've used it when we gather to pray for a friend's healing. But God has also used this passage to remind me that you need to gather with people to pray. You need to pray. In general, this is one of those passages that reminds me to come back to Him to pray. It reminds me to be faithful in my prayer. It reminds me that we need each other, that I need other people. Church, you have to remember, I'm going to lay this out there, be careful. I'm a regular guy. I'm like a regular person, okay? I struggle, I wrestle, I lose, I win sometimes. I'm a regular human. I fail. There's nothing exceptional about me. And so maybe that's why this passage actually sticks out for me. It talks about real people stuff that's practical. It starts actually talking about if you're in trouble, if you're happy, you need to pray. Both situations for us, I think we're taught this. We try to teach our kids this. We're strong, reliant, self-reliant people. We can accomplish things on our own. We don't need any other people. We don't need people. But what does this first part say? It says, when times are tough, pray. So what does it say? These are maybe some of the things that are tough in your life. Sickness, right? Hard. Financial stress. Broken relationships. More life stress. Maybe it's kids are stressful for you. Maybe there's other things. Grandkids. Grown kids. Maybe there's work things that are stressful. And what do we do in those stressful times? If you're like me, sometimes you're like annoyed at God, maybe, that this happens. Why does this happen? God, why are you letting this happen? How can you let something like sickness happen in my family? Why would you let death happen? Why are financial struggles something that I have to deal with? Or why do relationships in my life break down? We focus on these things and we think about ourselves and we don't think about what it looks like to reach out and what happens. What are the feelings that start to come? We feel alone. We feel depressed maybe. We question God. How could you let this happen? We think that nobody likes us because we haven't told anybody. We grit our teeth like we're taught we can solve this on our own. And we eliminate everybody else from our life and God in many situations, because we're annoyed at Him that He would let this happen to us. And so we feel more and more and more distant from God, and in turn we feel more and more and more distant from the people that are around us, that are caring for us, that want to care for us, that we're actually called to pray with. But James calls us to that. He says, pray, pray even when times are tough. These are examples, and maybe you have other examples. You have other things that you could add to this that make your life hard. But pray and seek guidance, seek comfort, seek peace, seek joy, acceptance, direction, life, the things that a relationship with God offer, the things that when we're close to Him, we know is real, that we're receiving from a faithful God. Be faithful in your need for the things that God offers. Pray in submission to a God that controls, a God that's a part of, a God that wants to be in relationship with you. Pray. And then it says, pray when we're happy. This is easy, right? Maybe for some of you it's easy, but for me it also causes the other side of it. You know, pray when the things are good. Health, when you don't have to think about your health. Financial ease, right? Your health, you're like, well, I've been taking care of myself. I've been eating good. Some of you exercise. I don't, but some of you do, right? Financial, I've been good at managing my money. I work hard, so I got a raise. Strong relationships. Less life stress, maybe your kids behave. Don't get too personal. Right? But what do we do? Then we're like, we pat ourselves on the back. Good job. Good job, Mark. You've been working hard. You've been doing the things, and now your life is good. Instead of praying and glorifying God for the good things, we forget And James is saying, yeah, don't forget, even in times like that, to pray that the God who is restoring our hearts and transforming our lives from the inside is also one that's in control of all of the situations. The ever-present God that is a part of our every daily life. Everything, all of the things. He's a part of our lives, good and bad. Hard and easy, fun and mundane. James is like exhorting us, almost like he'd be like, smarten up. Maybe that's how I feel like he's talking to me. He's telling me, he's asking me to acknowledge that there's hard things and there's good things, and I have a faithful God and a worship of faithful God who's faithful. And if I read through the Bible, he's faithful in the Old Testament, he's faithful in my story, and he's faithful in yours, and he's going to continue to be faithful. So pray, give glory to God. I do take some comfort in reading this, because James didn't know me, but at the time when he wrote it, the people needed to know this, and so I'm similar to the people that he's speaking to. I need the same reminder. It convicted me as well. It reminded me and motivated me to pray. The next few verses, I think, are a challenge because we reread them and assume that it says, if we gather the elders together and pray, if we anoint with oil, we will be physically healed. If we offer up prayers and ask God for healing, it'll happen. Almost like a foolproof thing. If we gather people together, this is what will happen. But I think that when we read this, we assume that James is only talking about physical healing. But as I did like discovery and read books and people that have forgotten more things than I know about these verses, I realized that they're on a spectrum as well. They would probably say that if we look at the book of James, we can't only think of this passage as physical healing, because that wasn't how James wrote. And so when I look at this, I think that James speaks to inner transformation as well as physical. He speaks about inner transformation, what God is doing on the inside spiritually in our lives will reflect our actions. It will reflect on how we behave. It will reflect on the healing that's happening, the renewed life, our results of what God is doing. So when we're faithful in allowing God to transform our lives, to change us, to make us new, to change our lives from the heart outward, he'll heal us spiritually. And James asks us to pray in faith, to be faithful in our prayer, to believe a God who's faithful will continue to be faithful when we're faithful and pray. He might heal us physically. He might heal us right away, even. But it might mean that in his timing, he heals us whenever that happens to be. You have to also remember that James, being Jesus' brother, is using Jesus as a frame of reference, right? He followed Jesus around and saw Jesus work, and he saw Jesus heal people. But he also saw Jesus physically heal people and spiritually heal people. If you remember in Mark 2, when the disciples bring this man paralyzed, and there's so many people in the house that they like dig through the roof and they lower him down. And do you know that Jesus doesn't just say, hey, can you move? Like, okay, you're healed. Like, he first, actually, when you read Mark 2, he first spiritually heals him. Your sins are forgiven, he says. And so then he realizes that the guy doesn't get up and walk. So, take up your mat, you can walk. The frame of reference that James uses is that Jesus heals spiritually as well as physically. We know that in when James talks about this, he's watched Jesus heal people spiritually. This is the context that he's using. He saw Jesus heal people, and that's the reason that he came, is to heal them spiritually. That's the reason that he died on the cross. That's, church, this passage is a reminder to be faithful, to pray, to follow after God, to bring our good and our bad before him. It's a reminder to gather together with one another. It's a reminder that we actually need each other to pray, to gather with each other. But most importantly, it's a reminder that God cares most about the healing of our hearts, about our spiritual well-being. if we're only speaking about physical healing when this whole book is about spiritual transformation, we would be off base. And I think that in this passage, it reminds us that this healing, this transformation is about all of us, is about the wholeness of his disciples, God's creation. We're at different points on this journey, but we're all seeking to be transformed, to be healed at some level by God. The next section of this passage is an encouragement and a challenge to me. Verse 17 starts with Elijah was a human being. Some translations say was a real person or was real. But in all of the descriptions, it just says, and he prayed, right? Even as we are. So a regular human, even as we are, and he prayed earnestly. God used a regular human like Elijah. If you go to 1 Kings 16, 17, 18, 19, you'll read about his story. It's pretty unique. God speaks to him in different ways. He acknowledges God as a faithful God, and Elijah is faithful in his prayer. So God uses him. And if you read in this section, God uses him. Maybe some of you farmers want to go to this passage and see exactly what Elijah's life was about. Uses him to stop the rain and uses him to start the rain. Pretty amazing, right? But God uses a regular person who prayed faithfully. A faithful God using a faithful prayer. God gave him strength. He gave him skills. He gave him wisdom. He gave him the things that he needed for the situations that God put him in. Church, the reason that this passage is real for me and encouragement for me is not because I have ever done that, stopped the rain or started the rain. I can't do that. I wish that that would be my story. But if I tell you my story, it would start with Mark, a human like you, only maybe more insecure and broken than you. True news. Real. That's legit. I worry. I'm afraid. I'm insecure. I get mad, maybe yesterday, at a son who was pushing me that way. Okay? I fail. I feel inadequate a lot of the time. I don't always do devotions or pray regularly. I sometimes remember to give God the glory when things are good. And I often try to solve problems on my own when things aren't great. Okay, I forget, and I don't appreciate the great community that God has put around me, and I forget to share with them and challenge them and allow them to challenge me. I don't always let people speak into my life, and the list could continue. But church, my prayer is that every day God uses me, even in my insecurities, in my brokenness. So my prayer is that in the day that God uses me and opens doors and I have eyes to see, I'll be personal with you today. Surprise, surprise. Lots of you don't know this, but I serve as the chaplain for our Lethbridge Hurricanes. So it's been like 6 or 7 years that I got to do that. I also serve as their mental health champion. I can't really define what that really looks like, but that's also what I do. I'll be honest with you, I know very little about hockey. I don't really skate well at all. I do have a mean slap shot in floor hockey, but that's about it. Okay, I'll actually tell you, this is some of you will realize how little I know. I cheer for the Canucks. Okay? Thank you. Right there, see? Stick together. But so church, I get to do this. This is not like I didn't grow up in the hockey world. I don't have special connections in the hockey. I don't understand the hockey culture. I'm learning, but God has opened doors for me to be a part of this. This is not in my comfort zone. Okay? That is not something that I'm comfortable doing, but God opens doors for me to be a part of something that's uncomfortable for me. I don't have the language. I don't know the people. And God opens doors. I have a chance regularly. I send a text to some kids and say, let's do chapel, some of our Hurricanes. And they say, when? When are you going to be here? Let's do it. So I show up and they invite me into their change room. And I do chapel right there. Or I show up after a game and I'm allowed to walk right into their change room. I have now had opportunity to do weddings for Hurricanes players and staff. I have had opportunity to speak life into families and walk alongside parents and players and siblings and have been invited into families. I've also had opportunity to walk along tragedy. And in fact, in Lethbridge, I've had opportunity, invited by Lethbridge Minor Hockey, which is not Hurricanes, to speak to other hockey teams because of my connection. Again, you have to remember, I'm not a hockey person. I don't know the hockey world. I, in fact, didn't even grow up in Lethbridge, so the hockey people don't even know who I am. And God is opening doors. I had an opportunity this last year to do a funeral for a hockey person in our community and got to speak some hope to 1,500 people in our community. And you have to understand, church, this is not my world. And God uses me, Mark, a regular human, a person like you, an insecure, maybe I'll describe some of you, insecure, afraid, scared, all of the things, person, to do extraordinary things. An ordinary person to do these things. That's what I love about this passage is Elijah, a human who prays, God uses to do extraordinary things. Mark, a human, reluctantly sometimes because I can be stubborn and pull my hat down and put my glasses on and walk through Costco and you don't recognize me, not talk to anybody and not acknowledge the fact that God is calling me to situations. Open my eyes and allow God to use me in my weakness. And I have seen God show up with words, scripture, people, all sorts of things, purely on the grounds of a faithful prayer that says, God, open doors. And I walk through them most of the time when I don't ignore them. And God uses me. Church, these are the things that we're called to do. Pray. This passage is about prayer. Pray faithfully, always. And God will use us. Elijah's an example of God using a regular, faithful prayer to do exemplary things. What sort of things is God calling you out of your comfort, out of your insecurities to do? Because that's what he wants you to do. What sort of things is he asking you to step into? Pray about, step into, so that he can make himself known to you. That he can transform you. With the end of this book and this chapter and the passage, James gets practical. Pray, church. Pray for each other. Pray alone. Pray together. Pray for others. Pray that no one quits. We heard that last week from Pastor Dave. Pray for perseverance for each and for everyone, for all of you. Pray for the souls and the forgiveness of sins of everybody. He calls us to pray, to be in relationship to pray. He calls us to be together, to gather, to pray. He calls us to pray that God heals physically and that God heals spiritually. He assures us that we have a faithful God who hears the prayers of the faithful and will answer. Right? It says, in this passage, I'm not going to find it now. But he says, when we pray, God will answer. He'll show up. He'll be there. He assures us that God hears our prayers. He calls us to be in relationship with each other. James says, be in relationship so that you know, so that you'll share, so that you pray. Be in relationship with each other. But he also says, be in relationship with God. Faithful relationship. Pray. Have conversation. This is the scripture that someone read to me this week. It's from Ephesians 6. It's Paul writing to the Ephesians, and this translation that you're going to read is from The Message. But it calls us to keep on. We're called to support each other, to love each other, to pray for all of those that have given up. It says, in the same way, prayer is essential in this. ongoing warfare. You need to know, like, the passage right before this is about putting on the full armor of God. Paul acknowledging that our battle is real, that the battle for our souls, for our lives is one that's real and spiritual. And so he says, put on all of this armor, but he ends it with, make sure you pray. Pray hard and long. Pray for your brothers and your sisters. Keep your eyes open. Keep each other's spirits up so that no one falls behind or drops out. We're called to be in relationship, to support each other, to love each other, to pray for each other. James calls us to faithful prayer so that God can continue transforming us, continue making us new. This week, in preparation for the end of this series on James and this message, I have four questions for you to contemplate. These are the four things that I want you to think about and pray about and allow God to work. They're on the backs of your bulletin. So if this screen all of a sudden disappears and you don't have them to pray, they're on the back of the bulletin. But here they are. What situations, good or bad, are you not giving over to God? Whether they be good and giving God the glory for the great things that are going on in your life and the little things and the great things and the mundane things that you can be thankful for, or the bad things, the hard things that you actually need to lay before him. What are those things? Maybe there's a way that God wants to heal you. How is that? Maybe it's physically. Maybe it's spiritually. Maybe there's something in your life that through this series God has said, that's something I want to change and needs to be transformed. Maybe it's this. How is God asking you to stretch yourself in life situations? Maybe that's significant because I choose, tendency to choose, the path of least resistance, the easiest path, right? How is God asking you to stretch yourself to sometimes do things that are hard, that take us out of our comfort zone, that make us feel inadequate so that we can't do it on our own power? And God is transforming us. And who is God asking you to pray for? Maybe there's people in your life, in your families. I got to pray with a young man in the first service who just wanted to pray for his family. Maybe there's people that you need to pray for, that you need to lift up. Maybe it's a spouse or kids or family, but who is it? Maybe a neighbor. Who is it that God is asking you to pray for? We're going to close. I'm going to ask the team to come forward. For those of you that are watching live, please join us in prayer. But we have, through this whole series, invited people to come forward and pray. Whether it be with us or alone, but to come forward and pray. And today we want to do the same. And there's going to be a few of us standing on the sides ready if you'd like to pray with us, or we could pray for you, or we could be with you as you pray. But maybe God is calling you out and this is the place that you need to pray, and stepping out into something that's uncomfortable and coming here before him on your own and praying that God help you, that God convict you, that God continue to transform, continue the work of transformation that he's started in your life. But I want you to be courageous. I want you to allow God and allow God to work and allow God to speak to you. And I want you to listen for what he's trying to do in your life. It's different. It's going to be different, your transformation than mine. But allow God to do that. Be courageous to step out into uncomfortable, into the places where you feel insecure, in relationship with people. But allow God to transform you, to restore you, to heal you the way that he wants to.